name is Alessandra Moctezuma, and I'm the gallery director here at Mesa College. And welcome. Thank you for coming. And first of all, I wanted to thank, well, of course, Louis, but also the students from the Museum Gallery Studies class sitting back there who helped with the installation and with the reception. And, well, I'm very happy to present the work of Louis Hock. Southern California Cinemural was actually created in 1979, and some of you might have seen that original version. It was created as a film triptych, and it was projected onto various public environments in LA, San Francisco, and San Diego. The current piece maintains the 8x30x70 minute format, but has been transferred to DVD and is projected onto the gallery's back wall. I was interested in showing Southern California here at the college because it dealt with our region and with the mythification of this area. And just wanted, before Louis talks to us about this piece and his work, to tell you a little bit about him. Louis Hock began making films when he was pursuing his BA in psychology at the University of Arizona. In 1973, he received an MFA from the School of Art Institute of Chicago. In 1977, he joined the visual arts department at UCSD. Since 1976, Hock's films, videotapes, and media installations have been exhibited in one-person shows at numerous U.S. art institutions, including the Museum of Modern Art in New York, the Whitney Museum of American Art, the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, among others. In 1986, Hock completed a four-part, four-hour video about the life and times of a community of undocumented Mexican workers in Southern California, the Mexican Tapes, a chronicle of life outside the law. This series was broadcast internationally on PBS in the US, BBC in the United Kingdom, and Televisa in Latin America. He also created a film, a full feature-length film called La Mera Frontera, which centered around the last military battle between the US and Mexico in 1918 in Nogales. La Mera Frontera was exhibited in numerous national and international film festivals and symposia. I believe that Louis is going to talk to us about his public art practice, which started in 1980. In San Diego, he presented a piece in the Super Bowl that dealt with undocumented Mexican workforce. And it was a bus billboard project titled Welcome to America's Finest Tourist Plantation, and some of you might remember that. Then in 1993, he created Art Rebate, Arte Reembolso, sponsored by the Museum of Contemporary Art, San Diego, and the Centro Cultural de la Raza. And he also has collaborated with David Avalos, Elizabeth Sisco, Deborah Small, and Scott Kessler in many of his public art projects. Hock has been the recipient of numerous awards and grants, including the National Endowment for the Arts, the American Film Institute, and the Rockefeller Foundation. At the university, his research is associated with the Center for Latin American Studies, the Center for Research in Computing and the Arts, and the University of California Digital Arts Research Network. And I hope that you come back to see the show, because it is 70 minutes, so you probably just got to see part of it. And it will be running continuously in the gallery, so we hope to see you there. Now, here is Louis Hock.
Whatever. I think I've got this mic under control. Thank you for the kind introduction. I'd like to thank Alessandra for inviting me to do the show, and Pat Vine for helping installing and helping with the opening, and students here who have helped with the installation. So the cinemural was made in 1979. And It was made 2 years after I moved to San Diego. I decided that I was really here. I was not in New York, and I should make a film about where I was. And so I made the Senior Mural. I read a wonderful book by Carrie McWilliams called Southern California, An Island on the Land, and I stole the title, and then made the work. And I was struck by the book because it was very readable, but also gave a really astute and prescient history, prescient knowledge about Southern California. So I'm really delighted to see the work, and I love the way that it looks. I haven't seen it in 20 years. I mean, it's not, I mean, I have it, I had the tin, I had the text, and I had the images, but until you actually see all three put together, you can't see it. So it's like an old friend. It's quite nice. I want to talk about a few things tonight. I want to talk about the what led me to make mural, the life of the work as a public art form from 1979 to 83, when I actually showed it as a public artwork, and show some slides from that. Talk a bit about its relationship to some of my other work, and then link it, because it's interesting to come back to link with the work that I'm, actually a work that I've just finished a couple weeks ago. And I'm going to leave some time for questions at the end. If you have something that's burning that you want to ask in the middle of it, that's fine as well. So how did I get to making a scene mural? Well, I was a filmmaker, making film for 5 or 6 years. You'd make a film, and it would be exhibited in a lot of places. You'd have the metropolitan places like New York, LA, Chicago, but you'd also have places like Denver and Seattle and Miami, and a lot of places that you would exhibit work. And I was living in a lot of places. I was living in New York and Tucson and Dallas, Fort Worth, and other places. And so I'd make these films, and there was a scene with critical comment on these experimental films that I would make, independent films. And there was a lot of writing about the films and a lot of discourse between filmmakers. And there was public support, not only for the places that showed the films, but also for the filmmakers themselves. It was easy to get, you know, not huge grants, but a modest grant to help you make films or finish films. And so there was this body of work that was produced by a large amount of filmmakers in the United States, and there was a lot of exhibition and writing. I went through the cycle a couple of times, you know, and I started going back to the same places that I had shown films before. And so I looked up, and I'm sitting there in a prestigious institution in New York, and looking out at the audience, and it's like, these are the same people at my last screen. Mm-hmm. You know, I know almost all these people, and who's here? There's the filmmakers, there's the wannabe filmmakers, there's the critics, there's the wannabe critics, and there's a little old ladies in back that come to all the screens. And that's it. And the little old ladies are the only honest audience members. You know, and they always ask, well, do you ever think they're telling a story? And always. And then they ask the same question both times, right? So I thought, you know, there's no audience. I'm making these films, they're not cheap. I spend a year or so making them, and the audience is good size, but there's no audience. So, you know, I thought, you know, maybe if I was a poet, this wouldn't be so bad, but, you know, there's a potential for this that's greater than what I'm realizing. So, and I'm not so sure if it was, you know, a great welling up of a sense of sort of populist propulsion that made me want to do a scene mural and have a public audience, or just vanity, you know, relating to my work, but I wanted a bigger audience. So I thought, you know, what can I do that's going to bring me out of this sort of cloistered space, this black box, and make a different kind of audience, and sort of allow me to extend the sort of film practice that I've been doing, but change around the sort of people that were seeing it, and people that actually wouldn't see it in such a analytical or such an academic kind of way, but actually see it for what it was. So I made this film, wouldn't show in theaters. And let me start off now by putting on some slides. This was sponsored by an organization called Leica in LA, and it was the first place it showed. It was perfect. The gallery is exactly the same size. The back of a semi. It's great. So I wanted to show it in multiple places, and so I borrowed this truck and put a screen on it. And got a flatbed truck and put the projectors on. Now this wasn't, this is, 1979, and so I think when you look at the work, people don't understand exactly that the reason there's a delay between the screens has to do with one, me being a cheapskate and wanting to make three images with one piece of film. And the other is that it allows the whole thing to happen with language. But what I did is the film you see would show on this projector, and then it wouldn't take up on that projector. It would pass the middle projector and then show on that projector, and then pass over to this third projector and take up. And so the space between these was 22 and a half seconds. And so, and I knew that before I started filming. And so I made a film that would accommodate that physical difference in the time delay. And so that's why you get the three images. So, and then I showed it this wall here, showed it in Venice. And it's nice because Venice has some of its own murals, and so it was great to be able to interact with that. And here, I don't have an image of the actual vehicle, but I rented a one of those, the kind of RVs that terrify you on the freeway, the really, really big RVs. I rented one of those and parked it out here and put the projectors on the top of the Santa Monica Pier and projected onto that. And on all three of these screens, it was advertised, so people came to see it, but then you got the passerbys. The first screen, the first night, a band showed up, and it was this LA band. They played found objects, car mufflers, car hoods, they found hubcaps, barrels, like 20 of them. They showed up, started playing. So every time I did these, they would show up and hang out and play the whole time. It's like having an accompaniment. It was wonderful. And each of these screenings, I'll talk a little bit more about the ideas behind it, but I wanted it to be like a mural. I wanted it to be in a place for a while. So each of the screenings I set up, and it ran for a week. And then so it was in one place from dark to about midnight, and they ran for about a week. So people had a chance to look at it, come back and look at it, tell a friend about it. So it had a sense of self-advertisement. And it wasn't just like one film on a sheet in a neighborhood, that was shown on a weekend. It had a mural kind of character to it in terms of its temporality. And I did it, it was sponsored by the downtown Whitney, and I did it here in Little Italy. And I had to cover up the Italian flag to do it, so I had to get Tony's permission from Little Italy to cover the flag to show the mural. And it was great. You got all the community, and it ran for a week, and people would come out and look at the mural, and yell at the kids that were using roller skating in front of the screen, and old people would shoo them away. So it was good. And then I did second place in New York. I was riding here at the Staten Island Ferry. Did a rear projection as people came into the ferry, and I was totally struck by how you got these, these people that would scream out of their offices, bolt across the pavement, go down the steps, get on the ferry, and go home. And I had a couple of guys that would just, like those in the trench coats, the hats, the works, just stop, started looking, and they just stood there, and they watched the whole damn thing. And I was just, to me, I was just, I felt, yeah, okay, I've done it right. I've done something. I have a couple audience members here that really, are willing to, stop, break a schedule. So I was pleased with that. And it was great because, you had to walk sort of past the screen or through the screen. And I did it another place. It was the exact right measurement. And as you may notice, with some of these, you know, the place I put them was really critically important. It wasn't just a matter of finding a space on a wall. It had to be the right space on the right wall with the movement of the people, the lighting, the architecture. The place I really wanted to do it was on the wall in the arch in Washington Square. It's exactly the same, just right through there. And I lost the fight with officials there. And so I ended up with the third space in New York that I showed it in was in, they gave me a theater at Columbus Circle. And I couldn't figure out what to do, but it was a theater that had a curved wall, even more severely curved than this. So what I did is I put the projectors on the stage and projected to the rear so nobody could sit down in the chairs. They let it kneel or whatever, but it projected across the back rather than the front. So because I said I didn't want to show it in theaters, how can I get out of this? And it worked out actually pretty well. This was Pittsburgh. The Carnegie sponsored me showing this during some other events that were going on. They were having a festival. And this is the Westinghouse building. So I rear projected it. I covered the windows with the, you know, simple screens, and then projected it. The only place I ever blew a fuse was in the Westinghouse building. Sorry. So anyway, and again, it ran for, you know, I think it was 4 or 5 days. I think it was Monday through Tuesday or something, or the Friday through Tuesday. And so it ran again from dusk until midnight. And this is, all these range between like 1979 to 1983. And this is the last place I showed it. This was in a terminal that's under the ground in Denver, where all the buses come in and passengers come down and they board the particular kind of bus that they want to take out to the suburbs. And it was great because I could show it for a week, and these are regular commuters, and I could offset it 15 minutes. I figured out that I watched people and they waited usually between 10 and 15 minutes for their bus, so I could offset it 15 minutes a day, and over the course of a week people would have a chance to at least see the whole mural. And it worked out. This is actually my most favorite picture of the mural in installation. Mm-hmm. And what's also wonderful about it is there's not one person that's looking at the mural, but it's the most elegant picture. So, and this is a place in Florida, there was a festival called the Chinsegut, and it had a lot of public people coming to the screens, but also, you know, a lot of filmmakers there. And so we installed it on the beach in Tampa. So we just pulled a semi out on the beach on some plywood so it wouldn't tip over, and screened it. It was great. You could see it, all these condominiums that were surrounding it, and apartments, all the people on the balconies. And again, it ran for several days. I stopped showing it in Denver when some kid walking past a series of boxes for Dolly Parton came up to me and said, "Who are you a roadie for?" And it was just, I didn't have enough carny in me to keep going with this ocean of boxes and schlepping from city to city. It was a real event, and I just sort of ran out of steam, and so I stopped showing it. And so that's one reason I'm so pleased to show it now, so that I can actually be able to go to city to city with 3 DVDs versus 4 75-pound cases. So I also showed, I don't have slides, I showed it at UCSD, and I showed it as a special event in the San Diego Museum of Art, and I also showed it in the windows of the San Francisco Art Institute in San Francisco. So when I made this, part of the inspiration I had behind this was its connection to the mural movement. I spent a lot of time in Mexico, and I was really fascinated by Mexican muralists and their political commentary and the way they integrated the stuff into the buildings. And I was quite taken with that. And I was taken also with the way that they insinuated the murals in a graphic way into the buildings themselves, and the way that that worked and the way that the crowds had to interact with them. And I really tried to maintain some of that consciousness when I actually made the work and installed it. I was also struck by a guy by the name of Alexander Medvedkin, who in the early 30s in the Soviet Union put together these scene trains in which they would, because the Soviet Union was so, a lot of the rural areas were so separate and the cultures are so different, they used the trains as a way to shoot film, and then they would show the film, and it would move back and forth between the various communities and have a discourse that would use the film as a mechanism. And actually they said, you know, today we film, tomorrow we show. So they had a car with a camera equipment, the editing room, the processing, and this equipment for screening. And I was struck with that idea of being able to have a discourse with the people and their environments. And of course, I was shooting stuff in Southern California and showing to some of the people, audiences were in Southern California, some of the audiences were more distant. But the idea was to use that as a discursive mechanism to some degree, like Medvedkin, but also this idea of a public screen and the informality. I was also struck as another kind of influence that came in mind was that when I was in Mexico, I was hanging out, and I'd always been fascinated with these guys who would come to town, and they would have a flatbed truck, and they'd roll into town with a flatbed truck, two projectors, and the truck would have two projectors, some film tins, and chairs. And they'd come into town, and they would put up a screen, remove their projectors, set up the seats, and then go throughout the town, taking down the poster of the film they were going to show that night, and putting up a poster of the film they were going to show next week, and on the speakers on top of the cab of the truck, announce the film they were showing that night. And I hung out for, you know, a week cycle with these guys. It was pretty amazing. I was struck with this, you know, just string a sheet like a vacant lot, between between houses, and I was struck with that kind of itinerary in a very casual kind of way that the films were shown. Also, when I did this, as you might imagine, it had a real character of performance. I mean, when one reel ran out, I had the film kept going. I would just unreel it, and then I would just splice on another reel and put it on so it could run continuously, and then I would take the take-up reel and then go and take another one and go, you know, some nearby site and rewind the film, and in the next 70 minutes I'd put another one on. But also it was like the early Lumiere, the first film screenings, had this role of both being sort of the mechanic and the question answerer. And I answered a lot of questions, you know, with showing this in public. One of which was big, is like, what are you selling? And then I'd say, well, you know, text, image, advertisement. You know, it's not marble, it's not bronze, they're not thinking about it in a kind of context other than advertising. So that was great, and so mostly I just said, watch a little bit of it, and so then they easily see that it really wasn't exactly like advertising. Also, you know, some of Jürgen Habermas's stuff about the public sphere is beginning to be translated. But the idea of this space where people being able to have a voice that's not governmental, you know, that's a sort of a private political voice that has some meaningfulness. And I guess, last of all, the influence, you know, thinking about Warhol, I was in a peculiar situation when growing up in Tucson, Arizona, and they showed Empire in Tucson at a very, you know, not too long after it was made. And it was great. It showed for, you know, Andy Warhol, Empire State Building, runs for a really long time. And I was used to, you know, early on, you know, you went to the theater and you kept quiet, you know, and you didn't talk. And then, when you get an independent films, they were really picky about, you don't talk, you don't squeak, you know, you don't unwrap candy. And then they went so far as to having one place, an anthology, these individual booths with walls between them, so you had no interference of anybody near you. So I thought, you know, the beauty of this, of the Warhol piece, it ran for, you know, it was 8 hours. You'd go, you watched it for a while, You go out, you wouldn't just go to the bathroom, you'd go get a burger, you know? And then you come back, smoke a couple cigarettes, come back, you know? And it was like, and you could talk, you know? I mean, it was an informality. The screen was not sacred. You know, it was something that could be, there was a casualness to it that I thought was really wonderful. The way that you might be in front of a painting or some other kind of form, you know? And so I thought, well, gee, you know, maybe that'd be a pretty good thing to do with film in public space, to think about that. People could come in at any time and leave at any time, and that, you know, they weren't going to pay attention to every moment, but it had to be successful in a way that they could watch sections of it and casually have it work. So, let me show a few more slides here. You know this, right? And my idea is to make a film about the mythological landscape. And it was not only about the landscape, you know, sold to others, but it was also about the people who lived in California buying into that mythological landscape. That was a thing that really struck me is incredible. And it was an image, which is a self-created image. I mean, California was the first state to advertise itself. I mean, they sent boxcars of oranges, you know, to the Midwest to get people to come here. I mean, it created, you know, it's a sort of living advertisement trying to create an image for itself that would attract people. And so I chose imagery which was very much like postcards. You know, it had the saturation, had the sort of hyper-reality, no smog, sunsets reoriented in the sky. I didn't quite do that, but, you know, all the foam wires painted out. You know, so you had this kind of quality of a landscape that you know, was there, but it was, you know, really sort of not there at the same time. And almost to the point of make-believe. So I developed a text that I would play against that, you know, the subtitles that would come across that would play against the text in some way for the two. There'd be this kind of interaction from the two, and one would have a critical voice, and one which would be essentially the, you know, the cliche, the postcard. And that was one of the ways that it really differentiated itself from the advertisement in the picture. In the image, didn't act in concert, they acted in opposition to each other. So the self-perpetuating myth struck me when I was on the East Coast and I was at a Thanksgiving dinner and someone from California described the postcard version of California which they lived in Los Angeles. You know, and, you know, they didn't talk about the smog, the traffic. They talked about, you know, the beach, and nice skies, the great sunsets, and the flower, you know. And I kept thinking, yeah, but, you know, I've been in traffic with this guy. You know, it's like, come on. And so the idea that people live there sort of create their own reality, and the reality is like the postcard. And so in some ways, it's as if it feeds on itself. And I thought that was very interesting. So I presented the image that people imagined they populated, which of course is really reinforced by advertising. And a lot, I think, probably has to do with the proximity to the movie-making industry, which is a, sort of dream makers, fantasy makers, big time. And of course, the subtitles are sort of a whisper in the ear about, you know, like are you sure about this? Wait a minute. So this film work was transferred to DVD. I wanted to wait long enough till the digital quality was good enough that it would actually make it possible to show the mural. Because if I had done it 10 years ago, it wouldn't have worked. I mean, you had to be able to get a kind of lusciousness to be able to have it work. And when the technology arrived a few years ago in my mind, then I transferred it to DVD. Because 16mm now, I mean, it's quite possible to show it, but 16mm is obsolete. I mean, they're stopping to make certain kinds of film stocks and the like. So it's not something that I can sort of go back to. I mean, the DVD is not simply a choice, it's an inevitability. And also, it'll probably protect the film from you know, from giving some further life that is, you know, beginning to go in terms of color. Film does not last that long. But I still wasn't ready to show it in a theater. And on the other hand, I knew it really wasn't public art anymore in the same kind of way. So the gallery space seemed the perfect place for it. The video projection in public would certainly be possible. In video, I mean, I could set up the projectors and show it like I had in the past, but maybe even better than the film because of the brightness of the projectors. But, you know, it's like a lot of public art. It was made at a, you know, particular place in space I commented on, but it's also a particular moment in time. And, you know, the cinemural rubbed against and competed with the advertising that people were seeing at the same time and the lives that they lived. And I was really conscious always, you know, if I showed it in the West Coast in the kind of way that they would read the film, and when I showed it in Florida or I showed it in New York, very different kind of reading with the film. I got different kinds of questions. So I thought that was very interesting. But by moving it 20 years down the road, I think that it while it's as a public artwork, it really would not work. And so I'm happy to move it into the galleries, out of sync. And it's out of, you know, the passage of time has rendered it, you know, not a public artwork. There's a loss of immediate comparison that won't allow it to happen. The cliches in the 70s are not the cliches of the 2004. So, you know, when you're driving down and when you're seeing the mural, the cars that Cal Worthington is trying to sell you are in fact no longer the same cars on the freeway. However, Cal Worthington is still on the TV. So that's, I mean, he's eternal, you know. And the cars all look like, you know, a parking lot's like a vintage car ad or something. It's not like it's the cars you actually drive. So anyway, nobody under 25 has actually ever seen it, a 20-acre orange grove in California either. You know, it's like, I think I got the last one of the Irvine Ranch. So it's valuable to me in a different kind of way. What happens, it throws all the weight onto the actual work itself. I mean, you strip away the performance, you strip away, you know, the public art part of it, and you're actually just, you know, looking at the mural as it exists in itself. I mean, and you strip away the sort of milieu that it actually was sort of born and shown into. So you pay much more attention to the text and the visuals. And it actually enters into, you know, this whole Patrick Ireland space of the white box as a pedestal, and certainly it has. And so, to me, when I saw the gallery, it was perfect, because the gallery is exactly the right proportions for the mural. So it's a good test to see if, you know, it holds up, you know, if you can scrutinize the experience of it and it works just as it is, you know, is it an autonomous entity? This work led to other public work. I was struck by the question that people say, what are you advertising? You know, what are you advertising? That's great. But if they see anything that's, you know, that they don't know what it is, and it has words in it, you know, in an image, they're going to say, what's for sale? So outside here, you may recognize this. This is near Hoppethul Road. There, the Secretary of Interior, James Watt, was proposing to sell parts of the parks into private hands. And so, there's me. And so, I thought I'd take advantage of that question. Here's where I put the searchlight, so the prism. And there's the Interstate 8. And here, putting up this stuff. This is the highway reflective material I bought surplus. Made these letters. This is like 2/3 the size of the Hollywood sign. And I got a searchlight, ironically, put it into a prism. And put this tiger stripe sign, nature, across the... And you can see the robe is here, and the sign was here, and the light was there. And it was great because I set it up on a ran on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, and it was over the Memorial Day weekend. So when you're driving the freeway, when you approached it, you saw this beam of light, not purple, I guess, but the blue beam of light. And then when you caught about 20 seconds, like a highway, you know, markers, so that you were, when you were on it, you could actually see the sign that said nature. So you can see the line of cars, the freeway, and the sign. Now, I wanted to see if I actually, my question had any validity. So I went down to the cafes on either side to see when people pulled in to get gas or people pulled in to get a cup of coffee, if they were asking what's for sale. And they got it. So it was pretty good. I mean, they say, well, that's parkland. Is that for sale? What does that mean? So I thought in that way I did play out my own question. You see the freeway down below. Also did it in a more celebratory fashion. Here in Portrero Hill, when they declared this thing which has been open, I think, owned by AT&T, I think, and they turned it over to public use, primarily for dogs walking. But I just did it across from Portrero Hill, using the same setup for more of the celebratory. And then this other aspect of public art, which was mentioned by Alessandro, I'm not going to talk too much about, but we did this bus poster when the first Super Bowl came to San Diego, and we bought half the city's buses to let people know why it was such a good place to have a Super Bowl. And then that was 88, and I worked collaboratively in these two pieces with David Avalos and Liz Cisco. And this is the art rebate 1993, in which we rebated $4,500 to undocumented taxpayers. Both of these were largely public art, but they were operated in the media more than having a tangible object. Mostly the objects were catalysts for activity in the media. I also made, as mentioned by Alessandra, another aspect of wanting to continue this notion of public. I made a four-part, four-hour series on a community of undocumented Mexicans living in San Diego, which showed widely on, showed in art places, but showed a lot on public television in Europe, or Latin America, and in the United States. So a different kind of way of moving outside of that kind of cloistered box. And I had a film about a topic that people wanted to know about. Was allowed tremendous kind of liberties with the way that I actually made the work relative to the conventional documentary work that showed on television. So I felt good about that. Now also, at the same time I'm doing all this, ever since I've started making film, I've been doing installations and galleries. It was, you know, I always saw it as different work, and it had a different kind of audience and a different kind of space of operation. And most often this installation work had some kind of media component. Sometimes it dealt with some of the same topics as my other work, but it was intended for, you know, people walk into a gallery and see these entities which were composed of the installation. So this here was one of the two I'm going to show from the mid-80s. This was, I think it's Langdon in San Francisco. And it's called Domestic Penance for Catherine. Somebody told me a story about having believed they were molested by their father, but their father dying before they could actually find out, and it was sort of haunted their whole life with this wondering about their father. And you're right, I did steal Kobe. From one of his billboards, and this is a installation which uses media, both, you know, these are just billboard fragments. I was struck with this idea of taking this totally hokum setup, you know, and being able to take it and put it in on, you know, on a monitor like this, so it actually had a great deal of credibility. This other piece I did was called Seeing is Believing. had a couple of videotapes here, but had these, again, billboard images. But I was struck, you know, with the way the TV, you know, made things seem so often so live and so dangerous. And so I had these two images on the television monitor, not so well reproduced here. And one was generated by a photograph on the wall, and the other was just the sort of hokum chicken wire kind of entity on the floor, which generated another kind of image. I have the pictures reversed. So this is a... And so I find myself in an interesting state now where this work, which came out of my filmmaking, that was an escape from filmmaking into a public art context, a public audience, has now worked its way back into a gallery. And so it's very, and then the installation work I've been doing, which has always often had objects in it and connected to the media element, now I'm recently making some installations that don't have any objects, that are just video images that are projected on walls and audio. And so I find this collision between these two very different kinds of practices that I've had in my art career. And so I think that some of it is just by the context. I mean, the independent scene that I described of filmmaking has, the 1980s has, I mean, it's disappeared. Actually, it disappeared in the 1980s, began in the 70s. And now when you say independent film, what you're talking about really is someone who doesn't make a Hollywood film but has the same aspirations. You know, it's a commercial film, which is not connected to the industry. And there's very few non-commercial theaters in existence anymore. Mostly they're attached to large art institutions. The critical discourse and publications are, not there anymore. And the film has gotten really very expensive and to this point being, obsolete. And so there's, the scene's gone. And so a lot of younger people still have a desire to make films and videotapes that are not traditional commercial narrative kinds of films. And so the real outlets for these people are either to go on the net and do these, small films or whatever, or they do works that end up in galleries. And so if you go to Documenta or Biennales or galleries, you see tons of film and video on walls because, that's where stuff can get shown. And so they still have a desire, and that's where the primary outlet for that is. So it's interesting to me that now that I'm showing the work in the gallery, the media component has become more present in the foreground and sort of thrown off the object, that's, that sort of collides with the moment of the time, but also these two areas of practice in my work. So I have a few minutes. I'm just going to show just very brief clips from two walls of a video installation called Feral, which I just finished. This is one of the images. And this is a, I won't show all of it. This is an eight-minute loop. And this is, I think probably for some of you, this actually looks kind of exotic. Other of you, it looks really familiar. It's just the golf off TV. Well, part of golf off TV. The golf, just the ball, but none of the rest of the stuff. I was always fascinated with this. They have a very strict series of sequences they go through. And the ball in the air, sometimes goes toward, it takes on various kinds of motion relative to the camera and the like. And I was struck with how this moving thing became, like a lot of other kinds of things once you shut away its context. So, and I was interested also playing this really sort of gritty, kind of funky video processing that kind of is like a B-film kind of background that might be behind something like a Godzilla or some kind of crazy volcano film or something. And put that, put that on the wall and then play it off this other image, because I'll show you right now.
Does it eventually hit the ground?
Never. At one point it leaves a frame slightly, but no, it just, it goes. I mean, it does, you know, go through, there's a whole cycle of color and clouds and, I mean, and sort of meteorology that moves around it, but it never actually lands. Because it, you know, it's about a, it's about the imagination, you know. This is a reality. This is like a 14-minute one take, same guy. This is a reality, which, you know, everybody experiences, you know. And it used to be that, you know, it was just, if you were brown, you had to worry. But now, everyone, you know, has to, you know, be under quite a bit of scrutiny. And so, you know, it used to be this was the Border Patrol, and now this is the Homeland Security. And so, you know, you have this one hand, you never know when you read the paper if you should be, you know, totally scared out of your socks because you're going to be blown to smithereens tomorrow, or is it like Reefer Madness, where somebody's making up this stuff, and you know, and it's not real. And so, to me, you've got these two poles, sort of this other stark reality which you experience, and this other, which is sort of, is it the B film, or is it, or is, you know, are you really should be worried about, you know, the soil you're standing on. So, I these are two opposing elements that I thought were interesting to play off of each other, and both because of their difference and because of, at least the metaphor of my thinking about, you know, what happens when I open the newspaper.
Is this the stage, or this is the...
This is real.
Okay.
Well, there's a pylon that's right here. A pylon, my camera, and this guy.
Just back to that, how, you know, notice, of course, basic fluid, how the lighting, right? You just feel like the whole thing is like this.
Well, this is really good lighting.
The light is amazing.
Yes, I shot a lot of them, and of course, it's sunset, so the light's just coming on at night.
It's fine with lighting, right?
Yeah, this is the lighting, the nighttime lighting is coming on, but you still have light. As the 14 minutes go, it actually turns to blackness. So eventually you have, you know, he's just lit in his background. And of course, he's a very able performer, so he walks backwards and forwards, and rarely, only once glances at the camera, so it's...
He's aware of everything, right?
He's, you know, and I did a whole bunch of these guys, and...
How did you get permission?
Or did you?
Not easy.
No, it was, well, I couldn't do it today.
Okay.
I did it, about 5 years ago.
So he knows he's being filmed?
He'd be filmed. I filmed a lot of people. I asked him if I could, and they said yes. And, I told them that if they backed up, their face would show. And they knew that. And some said they didn't, but then when they went to the next 15-minute shift of doing this, they didn't, you know, they just gave up. They didn't care. And this and another guy had all the right moves. I mean, they're really, you know, really nice. I mean, they're really good moves, you know. It's both, obviously, like weightlifters. And that, you know, really, you know, had great gestures.
It's,
you know,
very sexy.
He is. But the other guy, there's another guy has very, you know, very, both of them were very hot numbers.
Don't show the number of prices.
So, anyway, so... I'm going to kick this off here. So, anyway, I'm going to end it there because that's a good place to stop. The topic didn't bore you. The idea, as an artist, and many artists, always trying to figure out, like, where you've been and where you're going and like sort of direction, you know, because there's a lot of possibilities. And so I am thinking about these kinds of things, you know, and see, you know, what things I've done well, what things I've been a failure at, with things, you know. And so you're always trying to navigate, you know, what you're going to do and how you're going to do it. So this is the kind of thinking that I'm going through and sort of replication of it. Does anyone have any questions? Yeah.
So Southern California, you love it, you hate it, you love to hate it. What's the
hey?
Where's
I'm
the
a
point?
Native.
Yeah, no, that's fine. Doesn't matter.
So you know, I like Southern California. I'm interested in the reality of it, and so in a lot of ways, I think my fascination was the fact that people's love for California wasn't based on the real.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, it was based, in a lot of ways, based on a fantasy. And that fantasy is what interested me and actually is, you know, sort of, is exactly what the film is dealing with. Yeah.
Are the flower fields, are those the ones in North County?
Yeah. Those are the ones they use for seed, yeah.
And did they charge back then to move the flowers?
No, they weren't that clever. They weren't quite that clever yet.
Yeah.
And so I just went out there and did it. And of course now you have all those people out there picking their flowers. No, it was just there. Yeah.
What were the people's reactions to the public video at the time in different cities versus like random people that would walk by and look at those photos, people like let's say that you knew or other videographers? Was it like total different perspectives or totally different?
Well, it was curious. I mean, people, you know, in a lot of ways, you know, when you see those, I mean, some ads, you know, you see the horse, you see the wagon, you see Budweiser, you look at it, you know what it is. But those ads which have, you know, like a picture with no text, or a text with, you know, those are, you know, like, and it's a whole style of advertising. People would think, you know, they always try to figure out an ad, and people would sit there and look at it. And it was very interesting, because most of the people, when they came up and said, what is it, I'd say, well, just watch it. And they would hang for a while, and then they would come to their own terms about what it was. They still might have questions, but it would come to it. And I was struck with how engaging it was with people passing by. You know, because I hadn't had it in one place for a long enough time that they would pass by usually more than once or encounter more than once. So that they, even if they didn't have time at the moment, if they were interested the next time, they would spend time. So I had people actually, a lot of people came, didn't just see it once, or they saw pieces of it over a short period of time. And it held on to the people in the space. I mean, I don't know if it was just its peculiarity that had it work, or just something that was, you know, that it actually worked as it, because of the motion between it and the text and all that. What I think is interesting about the mural is the way that they actually used the physical spaces relative to the artwork, I thought was great. And I also thought was great is a sort of responsibility that they had in the audience. I mean, it was a direct address. It was not, it was an address which was a critical address, and it was about social content. I thought that's what I took from the murals rather than the style or, you know, the particular style of painting. Now the advertising was, the subject of the materials in the painting of the muralists was from the lives that they lived in. The subject of the film that I made was the life that I was living in. I mean, there are more pictures of trees than trees. So my landscape is advertising. And so in a lot of ways, that was the topic that I was dealing with. Also, the other part of the question is, yeah, people became really conscious about that period of time in terms of the language of advertising, the images of advertising, the strategies of advertising. I mean, you can go to Warhol, you know, are ones and a junction with art making at that time, and how, in fact, what kind of intersection can you forge there, and how can you have the kind of, you know, either you can use this stuff critically, you can use this stuff slavishly, like what is, you know, how does that junction form? And of course, each of the individual artists, whether it be Richard Prince or whoever else, figured out how they're able to deal with that environment they live in. Well, to me, there are two, with the ambience, there's two issues. One, you want to be able to have it so that, you know, people can talk, and they can walk in front of the screen, and they can come, and they can go. So you want to have enough of it so that people have a freedom in front of the image. On the other hand, in some ways you really also have to have it at certain points so they're grabbing by the throat. Because otherwise, you know, it's just like wallpaper. So it's always a balance between those two things. In terms of the cycle, there's a... Cortazar wrote a book, and I'm trying to think of the name of it, which was 54 chapters. And in the book, he asks you to... The chapters are obviously in order. In the introduction, he gives you a different order for reading the chapters. And in the book, each of the chapters, you can't kill anybody. Nobody can die. You can't have any termination in the chapters. You simply have to deal with the milieu. And for me, dealing with Southern California was perfect. I mean, that idea of dealing with the milieu didn't have to have a beginning and end. You just had to have pieces that had integrity in themselves. So each of the clumps of text, Right. Each of the images had to have an integrity so that when you engage in them, you have a sense of wholeness and then as a whole, you can't have the audience feel like they've missed anything. Well, I knew the images that I wanted to have together. And I knew the text that I wanted to have. And I knew the ideas that I wanted to connect to the scenes. But the particularities of the language and timing was done after the picture.
Right.
So I had the picture put together, and then I had to work out the timing. But I kind of did a little bit hand in hand. I kind of started writing, and I started moving the stuff around. But I wanted it, like there's some sections that don't have any titles.
Right.
And some sections of visual, which are very lean. And so I wanted, you know, the text sometimes to assume the foreground, and then sometimes the image to assume the foreground. So there'd be the sort of push and pull. So it wouldn't be just, you know, motion. It wouldn't be the left to right motion, and it wouldn't be just, it would actually be a foreground and a background where you'd have to read and look and read and look. And I think in some ways, you know, that back and forth this way keeps the stuff going as well as the stuff going sideways. Well, Abel Gance made a film in the 20s, which used three screens, which was, I actually didn't see it until after I had made this film. He tries to do narrative with the three screens. And
Napoleon,
yeah. Right. And it was pretty interesting to trying to do it with three screens, because it's a really wonderful film, but it didn't quite work as a narrative, you know. It sort of looked, the images came to the foreground, the narrative got buried by it, so, yeah.
I particularly like the way you made the text interact in a certain section, where you read it one way, and then another one comes, and then when they come all three together, it almost seems like they're going both ways, and the meaning shifts slightly.
Yeah, well, because you have to have a subject phrase, verbal phrase, predicate phrase, and then you can have them so that you can read them in any order, depending on the time. You can read 1, 2, 3, 3, 2, 1, 1, and the other two, or however you want it. So it's great.
Beautifully in some sections, it's really fascinating.
Well, another idea I had when I was putting the film on the DVD is how it connects with a lot of contemporary people working in computing and dealing with kinetic language. In conjunction with the images, I mean, just websites for that matter. And to me, it was, you know, certainly a much cruder kind of way to deal with it. But it was still that idea of a moving text and the fact that the movement of the text and the placement of the text against the image changes it as meaning. So I was fascinated with the way that actually has a contemporary kind of character to it.
You spoke about when you projected this up at Venice Beach. Then a group of street musicians came in with found object instruments. And
they were a group that played together doing that, yeah. They just showed up and invited themselves, yeah.
I'm curious, the old projectors that you used were probably kind of noisy.
Yes.
You had probably a generator running the projectors on the truck.
Some places I did, and some places I didn't. Some places I could tap into power, yeah.
But in the installation now, using DVDs, it's like there's no noise. And there's no soundtrack. Why did you choose to not include any kind of soundtrack?
Well, I mean, the soundtrack is always a problem with it. I mean, I use silent generators, so essentially you just had the projectors. The projector was far enough away from the screen that the noise was just, you heard traffic, you know, and people talking and everything like that. But I didn't want to have the audio with it because it's, I mean, just for, a lot of it was for practical reasons. And the other reason is that, you know, it removes it, I mean, is it removes it from the tactics of advertising by having an audio track. If you have picture and text, it's like advertising. As soon as you have the audio, it can be related to movies. You know, and I was more interested in not making that kind of reflex, that kind of observation of people. Plus, it's just hard to hear stuff in you know, public kind of spaces. And the image can be seen for a really long way away. Yeah.
It seems like you talked about very subtle in what it's talking about. You had specific ideas for specific scenes, but it's still very powerful in what it is saying. Did you find anybody like that was against you showing it anywhere? Did you have problems showing it anywhere?
Well, you know, there are people that, you know, mostly, you know, when you talk about public space, you're not really talking about public space, you're talking about private space in which the public engages with. So, you know, there were these. This Cadillac dealership in Beverly Hills has some beautiful big windows, and you know, and I almost got in there, and then they changed ownership, but it was, you know, right on, you know, it was great, it was right there on, you know, it was a great, and I couldn't do it, but mostly, you know, or just bureaucracy of park services or whatever else, mostly, you know, it wasn't the mural itself. No, the mural never, I mean, it wasn't the subject matter that ever bothered people, it was always just, you know, what's in it for me? Or how am I going to jeopardize my job by letting you do this? So it wasn't ever the content, it was always just, you know, the thing. You know.
So people yeah. were well
hoped. People were very, you know, tended to be pretty accommodating, yeah.
Did you keep any of your old audience from your previous audience from when you were making films?
Well, that's a good point. I think some people, I mean, people came and saw the work, but given the number of people, I mean, there were a lot of people that saw these things. I mean, you're down the Staten Island Ferry, you got a crowd out there, you know, and, you know, maybe you have some filmmakers like in there, but I mean, it's just a body of people. Or when I showed in LA, you know, there was like an opening and there was a lot of people and it went on for a long time. And then in Venice, it just, you know, you had lots of people there. So, I mean, I found places where there were people. I didn't go out in some farmyard, barn, and show it, you know, I knew where there were a lot of people on a particular kind of weekend, or a particular kind of crowd I'd see, and then I would show the work.
I guess I just mean that, you said you had the same audience as when you were making films previously, and a lot of critics, and I guess you were getting a lot of feedback about your work from that crowd. I wondered if they came and saw the new style, and got any feedback from them about it.
Yeah, well, it's, yes and no. I mean, there, I did, you know, people wrote about it and people did come and see it. But on the other hand, all those museums and everything that were showing it, no longer I say, they said, well, we'd love to show the work. Come in, we have a theater for you and everything. And I said, well, how about showing it downtown? And they said, well, audience comes to the museum. I said, well, I know they come to the museum, but I don't want to show it in the museum. So in a lot of ways, I lost a lot of institutional support in that way. And you know, some writing. You know, but not, you know, people wrote about it as film, but all of a sudden the institutional support kind of got pulled out because they didn't have it inside their institution. So, any other questions? Yeah.
I have a question about whether or not this is a critique linking the values of people who live in a Southern California setting and the lack of challenge in terms of winters that are hard, and are you saying that the values of Manhattan, because it goes through a real set of seasons and people have to really deal with the realities of it, that those values are more substantial than those who happen to live in a Southern California with blue skies and palm trees? I mean, is it a critique about the myth of Southern California makes the values of the people who stay here less substantial than those who live in an environment
Well, it's been my experience that New Yorkers have a lot less illusion about their environment.
It's about illusions and environment.
Yeah, have a lot less illusion about their environment than people live in Southern California.
So the environment facilitates having the ability to be capable of believing in a myth that's created about it?
Well, it's also about exteriority. I mean, I do think that a lot of Southern California has to do with the surface and what you can see. And I mean, like in like in New York, it's your coat that's important. In California, it's your car that's important. You can wear your underwear if you drive an expensive Mercedes, you know. And in New York, you know, it's like your person. So a lot of the personality gets extended into the landscape, whether you drive a car, or ownership of a house, or whatever else. So I do think the physical extension of self into the space makes that space more important, which also makes it more, you know, possible to have sort of mental fabrication around the value of it and what it actually is.
Yeah. I feel some sort of empowerment by seeing your work. I'm from Mexico, and this idea of social mobility is taking me 25 years to grasp. And I get empowerment just by looking at your work, seeing all this sort of like you're patronizing Southern California. I've lived 25 years in Southern California, by the way. So this question is very, very, you know, he arose with the subject of New York being this harsh climate that changes. Well, I come from Acapulco, which is sunny all year round. And I love your work. I love it because it gives another perspective to the sunny side of the world and this side. And then how do people perceive it in Florida?
You know, Florida, you know, it was
Florida, you have the Cuban influence, and there's other type of phenomenon aside from advertising.
You know, like the guy that ran the film festival said, well, this is just like Florida, except you wouldn't have to have the titles on the screen.
Thank you.